Two people sitting, having a conversation on the internet. You sit and think and wonder to yourself, is this a podcast? Welcome to the 10th episode of Is This a Podcast? I'm your host, David Thorne. I'm here today with my friend and comedian, Dan Smith. How are you doing today, Dan?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing just fine, man. So yeah. We're going to go ahead and get into it today. Just go ahead and tell me a little bit about yourself, Dan. You're from Sacramento originally, correct?
Yeah, well, I was born in the Bay Area. I was born in Walnut Creek, but I only lived there till I was four. And then I moved up to Placerville, which is a, those of you who don't know, it's a small town. It's about 40 miles east of Sacramento.
Mm-hmm.
So really fucking little boring town, so... I lived there until I was 25, and then we moved down here in 2005, so we've been in Sacramento since 2005.
Okay. And overall, so, you like the Sacramento area?
Yeah, it's nice. It's a nice area, you know. I like where we are, and I mean, this is home, you know. I've never lived any, you know, other than Walnut Creek until I was, I don't remember Walnut Creek, so.
Yeah,
this area is home, you know. I go up to Placerville now occasionally, and I feel kind of out of place up there now, but not that much, but like, you know, this area now is kind of, you know, Sacramento is home now, so.
Yeah, okay. Now, from Sacramento, did you go to high school in Sacramento?
You know, it's funny, one of my favorite stories, but I mean, I don't have a high school diploma. I don't have a GED. I don't have any kind of shit like that, but I do have a bachelor's degree.
What? So you don't have a high school diploma, yet you have a bachelor's degree. Did you go to high school?
Huh?
Did you go to high school?
When I was in high school, my freshman and sophomore year, I was having a lot of health problems. So I would have to do, you know, my schoolwork at the hospital or what have you, and I am not a good self worker, you know. I'm not good at keeping myself on track, so I didn't do shit. And, you know, I was in the hospital, so not like my parents made me do it or anything. One of the hospitals I was in had a school, and I never figured this out, but they never made me go.
Yeah.
So I did my freshman and sophomore year, but I mean, I did one semester my sophomore year in high school.
Yeah.
And it was all right, you know, Ponderosa High School up in Shingle Springs. It was all right. But after I did that, and after I had to drop out again my sophomore year, I just thought, fuck it, you know, why would I go? I don't want to start at the school my junior year for my last 2 years.
Yeah.
So I just said, you know, can I just do it at home? Can I do homeschool?
Yeah.
So I got a teacher sent out to me. My teacher would come out to me like three times a week and give me assignments and work to do, and she'd work with me. But I didn't do shit. Like, I didn't do the work that she assigned. Uh-huh. And she would come back next time and she'd be like, you know, did you do your work? Or, you know, and I'm like, no. She was one of those teachers. She was like, okay, we'll do it next time.
Wow.
You know, I don't know if she was just, I guess she was just trying to be nice to me, or I don't know, but she, you know, she, there were never any consequences for me not doing my work.
Gotcha.
So I just, you know, and then I found out when you turn 18, you can enroll in a junior college without any sort of high school diploma.
Huh.
So I don't know if you can still do that, because this was in 1996.
I thought you had to have like
fucking man.
I thought most places wanted you to have like a GED to get employment.
Yeah. Well, I wasn't trying to get employed.
Okay, but they don't care about the school just as long as you're willing to pay the tuition.
I don't know if that's changed since 1996, but at the time you didn't have to have a diploma to enroll in the junior college.
Okay.
So when I turned 18, I enrolled in the junior college, and I spent what should have been 2 years. I spent 4 years there at the junior college.
Oh, wow.
And then I transferred over to Sacramento State for 3 years. So my 4-year degree took me 7 years.
Oh.
So making up for lost time in high school.
So what did you say you had a bachelor's in?
Recreational therapy. Recreation as a modality for healing. When I was in the hospital my sophomore year, it was Shriners, but they were in San Francisco at the time.
Yeah.
So I was there for 4 months at one stretch. One stretch, like at the prison. But they have a recreation therapy department for the kids, unwind. And that's what got me through the 4 months there, was having the recreation department. So,
yeah.
You know, when I realized that recreation therapy was something I could do as a job, I was like, I want to do that. Because, you know, I want to give kids what I was given when I was a kid. So my dream job when I was in college was to become the recreation therapist at Shriners.
Yeah.
That was my whole goal the whole time in college. And then I had more health problems right after I graduated. And then it got to a point where if I wanted to do rec therapy, if I wanted to be the rec therapist, I'd have to go back to school and get my certification, which I never got. So I'm not a certified recreation therapist.
Gotcha.
But I did just get a job before the pandemic. At a day program for people with intellectual disabilities.
Oh, well.
So hopefully I'm going to be starting that at the beginning of June.
Hopefully so, man. Yeah, that sounds like sounds like a good deal.
Yeah, I was really excited. I haven't done anything in rec therapy in almost 10 years, though, so I'm a little bit nervous about it. But
You'll be fine, man.
Yeah.
I'm sure you'll be fine, dude.
As soon as we're allowed to go outside again.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I go outside still. I go walking around the park and stuff.
Oh, no, I know. I know.
You go.
You're not going to the restaurants with all the people.
Oh, God, yeah.
Not everything's open.
You mean like comedy clubs and stuff like that?
Yeah, it's like comedy clubs.
I miss standing out outside of those talking to people.
I
just want to go and hug everybody, you know, that I hadn't seen in like months. Well, I've seen a few of y'all on Zoom, but
I have the biggest fucking hug ready to go right for you. Everybody.
Oh,
you're number one on my list.
Oh yeah, dude, most
you guys
definitely.
Guys don't know this guy gives the best fucking hugs in the world.
Thanks. All right, man. Let's go ahead and move on to the next topic, and it's one of my favorite topics. I love hearing people's experiences that they've had with controlled substances, drug trips, things like that. Now, before we started recording, you had told me that you hadn't had many experiences with psychedelics, but you have did mushrooms one time.
Yeah. So, I've been a weed smoker since I was 18. I smoke on weed all the time, but as far as psychedelics go, I did mushrooms one time when I was 19, so it was quite a few years ago.
Yeah.
I remember we smoked some weed, and then my friend said, "Hey, you want to try? You know, want to try mushrooms?" I'm like, "Shit, yeah." So we ate the mushrooms, and I don't know how long they took to kick in. But like an hour later, we're just sitting there, like, I don't feel anything, you know. What's going on here? These things must be bad. So we took a little bit more, and about a half an hour later, I'm sitting there, and I said to my, and we smoked some more weed too when we had the other mushrooms, and we smoked some more weed, and I said, I'm sitting there, and I just realized, you know, I said, I am really fucking high right now. My friend goes, me too, and I was like, I'm not high on weed. I don't know what this is. So we just went outside. I grew up in the country, so when you went outside, the whole sky was just lit up with stars.
Oh.
So we went out on my back patio and put some sleeping bags down and just sat there and just tripped out staring at the stars.
Dude, yeah. I know. I had an experience one time where I'd laid down and looked up at the sky, and it just looked like kind of like a kaleidoscope and stuff moving around in the sky, and it was just like, whoa.
Yeah, I remember the stars kind of like float, like moving around in place, you know. Instead of just sitting there, they're kind of just wiggling around, and every now and then a shooting star would go by, and that was just trippy as hell.
Hell yeah. It was I think that was the first time that I tripped when I came out here on mushrooms.
Did you just start doing mushrooms before when you came out here?
Yeah, I had like done them once before back home, and they did nothing to me. I think they were like some bullshit. And
No,
then
okay.
I, when I got out here, yeah, I did like I got chocolates. We did chocolates, and it was a good trip. It was
Chocolate, is that a type of mushrooms? Chocolates.
Basically what you do is you grind up the mushrooms. And then you take chocolate in a saucepan and you melt the chocolate down. You
Oh,
drop.
I got
You
you.
just basically mix it in there and then you put it in a tray, throw it in the freezer. Once it
Yeah.
hardens up, you've got little chocolates with mushrooms in it.
Okay.
And then
All
you
right.
just.
When we did it, we just ate the mushrooms
Oh yeah,
straight.
that's how you'd normally do it unless you want to be
They weren't
extra.
very good. I remember that. I do remember that.
It's a helpful tip. Eat them with peanut butter. It's like peanut butter and crackers.
There you go. All right.
Eat
Makes
them with
sense.
peanut butter.
I want to try it again, so we'll talk about that sometime.
Oh yeah, most definitely, dude. I'm always down to go on adventures. All right, that was a interesting story. Let's go ahead and move on to another topic that I've asked everyone about. Something life-changing, like life-changing events. It could be like a decision you made that impacted you negatively or positively, but something you ultimately came out a better person for going through.
Better, but well, I think the thing that kind of comes to mind most is what led me into comedy, and that was meeting a comedian before my time, just before my time, who was also in a wheelchair. His name was Michael O'Connell. I don't know if you've heard of him or remember him, but he I got to see, I never got to see him perform actually in person, but I got to know him as a person. Hanging out with him, and like I wasn't into comedy at the time or anything, but he was a really nice guy. I'd seen his work online, and I knew he was a great comedian, and I just knew that I and then my brother-in-law at the time, another reason I'm getting into comedy is my brother-in-law at the time, he was just getting into comedy in 2014. His name Damien Harmony, you know him. I saw him out there, and I was like, I want to do that. I saw his name on the flyers. I thought that was just the coolest fucking thing. So meeting Michael and knowing Michael, and then seeing somebody I know personally in the comedy scene and doing the comedy, like, I thought, okay, I know somebody already doing it, and I've seen this person who is in this, he didn't have the same disability as me, but being in a wheelchair, he's like, and here's this person who was in the same situation as me doing it, so why can't I? Michael passed away in 2016, unfortunately.
I think I may have heard people in the community speak about him.
Yeah, he and Keith Littleton were pretty close, so everybody loved Michael. Just after Michael passed away, and knowing that Damien was in the scene already, that was kind of the life-changing thing of, okay, I can do this and I want to do this,
So you found that you're passionate about it and you want to do that. I feel the same way about comedy. It's one of my favorite things. I'm ready for it to come back like everybody is. I've said that a million times. I'm sure
I
everybody
miss the
else
stage
has.
so fucking much. I mean, people, like when people say, we'll do Zoom comedy, like, no, let's, that's, I heard somebody describe it. I don't know who it was, but I heard somebody describing Zoom comedy as like somebody reading, the novel War and Peace, and you take that novel away and you give them an Us Weekly. Hey, you're still reading, so it's the same thing.
Now, that's actually a topic I wanted to speak to you about that you bring it up is Zoom comedy. I mean, you've done a Zoom mic, correct? Or were you
I
doing
have
one?
not
You
actually.
haven't yet. Okay.
No, the
Now,
only one I've done was a pre-recorded session where.
okay, yeah, I did one of those, and I will say that didn't feel authentic because there was no audience. Now,
Exactly. That's the problem.
what I will say in the same vein, I've done a few Zoom mics. I've did two. Mm-hmm. I did one last night. It didn't go great. It was like, I did terrible. I wasn't in the right mindset, I guess. But the week before I did it, and I had fun. I was relaxed. It was a good time. It actually felt like performing to me. But, you know, it obviously wasn't the same, but I had a good time. It's still there a little bit because when people have their mics on, you can hear their reaction and stuff. So it's kind of cool. It's a substitute for sure.
Where are the mics that you're doing?
Like, I
putting them on.
I know that Buddy had posted something on Facebook.
Oh, that's right.
I'm going to try to get on that Tuesday. I think there's still spots available. So, yeah, I would hit him up about that. And,
okay, maybe I will.
Yeah, because I did. He put one on last night to, I guess, just like figure stuff out with it. Both of them that I did were ones that he put on. But
oh, okay.
I'm going to try to get some more links to Zoom comedy shows because I had talked to Danny D, and she said she had a link to send me that had a bunch of the links. Ooh. But Danny D, yeah.
Let me know. Give me that list if you can.
I'll try to follow up with her and get that list, though, for sure. But, yeah. So you said...
Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, you're doing your first Zoom comedy show.
Yeah. When I get the pre-recorded show, it's like, you know, or the mic, you know. And it's just performing in an empty room, you know. That's not like...
Yeah.
Even on Zoom, though, you're still in an empty room, and the laughs are just coming from the little speaker, you know. I need to be back on stage in front of that live audience and getting either the laughs from the joke or the relative silence from a bomb, you know?
I will say that the silence in the Zoom shows, last night it was bad, but if people are laughing, you get that same effect. You do.
Okay. All right, cool. I'm looking forward to trying it then.
Like, it's you just gotta, you do have a live audience. You're not there with them. You can't physically see them. But, like, some people have their cameras on, and you can see their cameras, and it's just, like, you can hear their reaction, you can hear the laughter, and it's, like...
Cool.
It's something, most definitely. If you haven't done it, you'll get something out of it, I'm sure. It's not bad.
Yeah, well, I'm doing it on Friday, so I'm, you know...
If not, you're sitting in a room with mostly comedians, you're gonna, like, probably talk and have a good laugh at the most, you know?
Yeah, that's true. That's true. I'm gonna hit a Buddy then and see if I can get on that mic.
Yeah, I would do it. It's the Tuesday one's open mic, and that'd be perfect to get your practice in before Friday. So I would definitely.
That's a good point. Yeah. Okay.
Definitely get in there because I was like, I didn't read it, and I posted asking him like, "Is this going on tonight?" And he like comes, he's like, "You can't read, but that's okay. It's Tuesday." And then I messaged him back. I'm like, "Put me on the list. I'll go last or whenever. I don't care." Because usually I end up going last at most of the open mics because when I was
working. You do.
Yeah. I don't mind. I don't mind headlining open mics. I got to get used to going last.
There you go. That's it. There you go.
Oh, yes.
Do you sign up last or do you just...
I like to stay around to the end, but the only bad part about that is sometimes the audience leaves.
Yeah, they do. That's true.
But if you go up last and you do well, it always feels nice. It feels like you're headlining.
That's right.
It's like I like to pretend that I'm headlining open mics.
Yeah, you closed it out.
Oh, yeah, close it out all the time. That's mainly because I get off work late and I'll show up to the mics late, and they're nice enough to put me on, which I always appreciate that. Stab's especially good about that.
I like Stab. It's just that room's so fucking small.
It is small, but it's a good room. It's very, very intimate. Like, if you can have a small crowd at Stab, and if they're laughing, it's just as good as having a packed room.
Yeah, it's not really the crowd that's the issue for me. It's getting around.
Oh, well, yeah. I didn't take that into consideration.
I'm in a wheelchair.
Yeah. I haven't really addressed that. I mean, I figured I'd let you bring that up. I didn't want to be like...
I'm a can't stand-up
comedian. He's a can't stand-up comedian. Yeah, I was like, I didn't want to be like... But like, here's Dan, he's in a wheelchair. I mean, that's
look
you, man.
At
you.
He's
in the crypts.
This is your benefit show, right?
Where yeah.
You
my benefit.
You need to get the invalid on.
So, you know. Oh, man.
So people can see what a good guy you are.
That is, that's funny, man. Something else I do want to ask you about, though. I know I've heard this from, you probably talked about this on the Gag on This podcast and probably many other podcasts, but I've heard that you auditioned for Mac and Me. You were in.
I did, yes.
So you could have been in that scene where.
That movie would have been, you know, an Oscar winner if I.
It would have been way better. You could have been in the scene where the guy rolls down the hill in the wheelchair.
You know what my favorite fucking part about that scene is?
What's that?
He's rolling down the hill and he goes to put on his brakes. And they just fall off. Who the fuck made that chair?
He could just
fall off.
That sounds like a lawsuit to me.
No kidding. I mean, second of all, if you're actually going that fast and you stop by putting your brakes on, you're gonna fucking fly so far.
You're gonna fall out forward, I would think, because you are.
You
momentum.
Ended up in a lake anyway.
That's hilarious.
But no, the brakes just fall off. It's like, who the fuck made that chair?
I can't remember how it goes. Doesn't, like, the little alien bring him back?
Yeah.
Little alien brings me back because I don't know the kid's name. I guess the alien's name is Mac. We'll just call the kid me.
I auditioned for the part of me, not Mac.
So
I could have been me.
It could have been me.
Oh shit! I missed that.
Hell, man, you should write a joke about that shit, dude.
Yeah, I should.
That's a good one. But yeah,
but
dude, that's
fun.
Interesting.
I remember that.
What was it like?
I was just gonna say they met with us at a hotel out by the airport. And my mom and my sister went with me.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just one guy. I think, I don't know if he was a talent agent or what, but we just read it. And I actually read the line. I actually read the scene after the kid falls in the lake.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and he's talking about it. And he's talking to his sister about, you know, I shouldn't have gone down there. You know, no shit.
No.
You know.
Yeah.
But that was the scene that they had us doing. They actually, when my sister was there, she like, and they actually had her read for lines too when they met her.
Yeah.
You know, so I guess we both auditioned in a way, but yeah, and then I was all excited, and then a few weeks later, I got a letter. And the fucking letter never says we're going with someone else. It just talks about what a good job I did. And, it's a letter you would send to somebody you don't want to offend, you know. I guess I was in a wheelchair, you know. So except at the very last line said something like, you know, we're excited to have so-and-so working with us, you know. Their name, that wasn't me, you know, but I didn't read that part, so I got all excited because they were talking about how great I was.
Yeah.
My parents didn't say, like, you didn't read this line.
That sucks.
Yeah. I think I still have a letter around here somewhere. I have a picture of it with it.
I think I seem to remember seeing you post it on Facebook at some point. That's why I wanted to ask you about it. So you went to
my brush with Hollywood.
You went to a hotel room by the airport. That seems like a
good idea. Isn't that professional?
just meet some random man.
I'm not even actually sure if he was with the filmer.
It was just some guy.
He just convinced us, you know, hey, come on and do an interview, you know, try out for a film. Yeah.
Oh, man.
And then when the movie poster was at our local cinema, I was looking at the poster.
Yeah.
And like three people came up to me like, oh my God, it's you. Oh my God. You know, because you could see the picture. And the kid kind of looked like me.
Yeah.
So I was like, yeah, it is me. Cool. Yeah. I was like shaking hands.
Oh, that's funny. You could have been that kid's stunt double. They could have actually like rolled you off the cliff. They're like, he needs a stunt double.
Dan Smith, professional cliff diver.
Oh man, that's funny.
Yeah, it was funny. It's a good, you know, it's a good memory.
Who was in that movie instead?
His name was Jade Calgary, and I only remember that because it's the stupidest fucking name I've ever heard.
That's funny.
So, you know, I don't think he ever, I don't think he was ever in anything else.
Now, I don't know why, but I seem to remember seeing on Conan O'Brien, I think it's whenever Paul Rudd's on there or something, yes. they show that clip, and I'm like, why? Why do they show that?
That's the only reason I'm mad that I wasn't in that movie. Because, God damn it, I could have been Paul Rudd's Eternal movie clip.
Exactly.
I could have been Paul Rudd's movie clip.
Exactly, dude. That's what I was wondering about. I was like, why do they show... Is Paul Rudd even have anything to do with that movie?
No, he doesn't. He's just fucking Conan.
That's fucking hilarious.
Like, the first time Conan had him on, he was, I don't know, he was promoting for a movie, and Conan rolled it. Like, Conan didn't know what was happening. I've seen... like clips of it, you know, yeah, as it was happening,
yeah,
but Conan didn't know what Paul was doing, so they ran the movie clip, and it was that Mac and me, you know, and then, you know, the clip ended and they came back to Conan and Paul, and Conan was just kind of sitting there like, what was that? Paul Rudd laughing. So then every time after that, every time they had Paul Rudd on, he would show that same clip.
Okay, yeah, yeah. I was wondering if that's hilarious.
Yeah, I don't know why how Paul Rudd ended up picking that one clip to fucking Conan with, but God damn it, that could have been me.
That's freaking funny as hell, though, dude. That is some funny shit.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we're drawing to the end. Usually at the end, what I like to do is, I know you do stand-up comedy. You said you have Zoom shows coming up. This isn't going to be up at any time where anybody's going to be able to come to your shows, but like, just tell me about what you have planned for comedy, if you got anything else going on other than stand-up.
Yeah, I've got this Friday, it doesn't matter where, but this week I've got I'm hosting a show called Body Posy. It's a body positive open mic.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm really excited to work with comedians that I'll be on the show with, and I'll be hosting. It's this Friday. So I'm really looking forward to that. And then at the end of the month, I'm doing a storytellers show. I actually don't really know much about it right now, other than doing it. And I know that my topic is going to be about the importance of music in my life and how it's, what it's gotten me through.
Yeah.
You already, I mean, you know, but my listener, music is like my passion. I love comedy.
Yeah.
I came into comedy later in life, but I've grown up with music, so.
Do you play music?
I don't. I tried to take lessons to play the guitar for a while.
Yeah.
I might go back to it eventually. Yeah. You know, I still got my guitar, but.
Yeah.
You know, like, the reason that I wanted to do it was, like, the thing that I connect with the music is not necessarily the music, it's the lyrics.
Yes, I'm with you on that. I'm a very, very lyrical-driven music listener. The beat and the music is cool, but the lyrics are where the meat of the song are.
Exactly, exactly. And I knew that, like, I can't sing worth shit, and I don't want to sing.
Yeah.
So, you know, when I realized, though, that, you know, I'm never going to be the front man, I'm going to be the guitar guy, you know?
Yeah.
That kind of took a little bit of the fun out of it, you know, because...
I mean, you can, you know, be a
friend. I want to sing my... So that's one of the reasons why I love comedy.
Yeah, you know,
I get to be the only one on stage.
Yeah. Well, I mean, who's to say you couldn't be the front man of a band if you really wanted to? It'd be something you...
I don't want to fucking sing, though.
Well, I mean, if you did, you know, that'd be...
Yeah,
you ever seen the front man of a band in a wheelchair? I don't think I have. I'm sure there's probably one out there somewhere, but no one big, man, that I know of.
No, I mean, there's not a lot of big people in wheelchairs in any media. The man's keeping us down. Goddamn man.
Yes.
So, I've never seen a band with a person in a wheelchair. So.
Me either. Should make one, Dan. Start a
band. I'm gonna be a singing comedian. I'll sing my jokes.
I like to sing sometimes on my stream. I just sing stupid stuff. Yeah, I just burst into song randomly. Sometimes I wish life was a musical, man. It'd be so much more interesting if people just randomly burst into song.
And that would be interesting.
Instead of shooting up schools, people should just randomly burst into songs.
Just burst into the classroom.
Instead of bursting fire, burst into songs.
Breaking the Hello Dolly.
Exactly. Just like go into school and start singing a musical. Oh, man. This has been fun. Well,
it's good to see you again, man.
Hell yeah, man. It's thanks for coming on. We're coming to the end here. I mean, I do appreciate you coming on and talking with me, Dan.
I appreciate you having me.
Do you have any social media that you want to plug?
I have a Facebook page for Dan the Can Stand-Up Comedian. And then I have Instagram and I have Twitter, but I suck at using them. Like, literally, you look at my Instagram and there's no posts. So Facebook is the best way to keep track of me. Like I said, it's Dan the Can't Stand Up Comedian.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Dan, for being on the show. Look forward to seeing you again when everything opens back up, man.
I got the hug all locked and loaded.
Oh, yeah, man. But thank you for being on, my brother. I will talk to you later.
Thanks for watching, guys. If you liked the video, share, subscribe, leave a comment, let me know what you thought. Follow me at Twitch @TheSouthernReject. Thanks.